Our next speaker is the Honorable John Leventhal, who is an Associate Justice of the Appellate Division, Second Department. He was first elected to the Supreme Court in 1994 and presided over the nation's first felony domestic violence court. He recently published a book entitled My Partner, My Enemy, about his experiences and cases in that court. His work on that court has been recognized nationally, and he is the recipient of many honors from various groups, including the Brooklyn Bar, Fordham Law, the Brooklyn Women's Bar, the New York Board of Rabbis, the National College of District Attorneys, and the United States Department of Justice. He has been profiled in newspapers and magazines, and most recently on NPR's Metro Focus. Please welcome Judge Leventhal.
Thank you. I just want to, you have material here, and is Edward Ray here? Edward Ray from Brooklyn Law School prepared, I supposedly supervised him, but he did such a fine job, I hardly had to do anything. You have every Court of Appeals case, meaningful Court of Appeals case, that discusses Crawford v. Washington in your outline. Having said that, this is a Sixth Amendment issue which is being decided all over the country, in the Supreme Court, in federal courts, in other state courts. So a lot of the issues, and what I'm going to talk about, I'm not going to regurgitate all of the cases that are in your outline. You could read the summaries within, and you can also read the full cases. But what I'm going to do is take you through the whole Crawford experience, confrontation after Crawford, and see how other courts have handled circumstances and issues that you may confront as either a prosecutor or a defense attorney, and see how they have handled it so that you will be opened up to the issues that are entailed. So very briefly, I'm sure all of you have read Crawford versus Washington, and I don't think anyone's going to raise their hand and admit that they haven't. But I will start out with a very brief summary. On March 8th, 2004, the Supreme Court decided Crawford versus Washington, and it was immediately evident to prosecutors, defense attorneys, and judges nationwide that the landscape of the rules of evidence regarding the admissibility of hearsay would forever be altered. There were many issues left unanswered and much uncertainty as to what extent the evidentiary rules would be affected. In this case, the defendant was convicted of assault and attempted murder. At trial, the state was permitted to introduce a recorded statement that defendant's wife, Sylvia Crawford, had made to the police as evidence that the stabbing of the complainant was not in self-defense. Defendant's wife, however, did not testify at trial because of Washington's marital privilege, which generally bars a spouse from testifying without the other spouse's consent. Mr. Crawford argued, that admitting the evidence would violate his Sixth Amendment right to be confronted with the witnesses against him. If Jackie Mason were here, he would tell you that's chutzpah, because firstly, he's going to prevent her from testifying, and secondly, he's going to say, oh, I can't cross-examine her because she didn't testify. But that's the circumstances of this case, and the Supreme Court, in a 9-0 opinion authored by Justice Scalia, reversed defendant's conviction. Chief Justice Rehnquist concurred, stating that the opinion casts a mantle of uncertainty over future criminal trials in both federal and state courts and is by no means necessary to decide the present case. How true he was. The Supreme Court, abrogating Ohio versus Roberts, a 1980 case, held that an out-of-court statement by a witness that is testimonial is barred under the Confrontation Clause of the Sixth Amendment unless the witness is unavailable and the defendant had a prior opportunity to cross-examine the witness, regardless of whether such statement is deemed reliable by the court. The Supreme Court rejected the proposition that out-of-court statements are to be regulated only by the law of evidence rather than the Confrontation Clause. The court neither provided a comprehensive definition of the word testimonial nor furnished an exhaustive list of what types of out-of-court statements are considered testimonial. The court did hold that, at a minimum, testimonial out-of-court statements apply to prior testimony at a preliminary hearing, plea allocution showing the existence of a conspiracy, testimony before a grand jury or at a former trial, and to police interrogations. Testimonial statements may be sworn or unsworn. Affidavits were included in two core classes of testimonial statements covered by the Confrontation Clause. That's a very important concept, affidavits. However, this case left more questions unanswered than answered. So, we know what the Sixth Amendment, that's the right of confrontation on the state, on the federal constitution, and every state has its own confrontation clause. And I'm going to say this now, and I'll probably say it again, that all the states under their case law, in their, under their state constitution, have not given a defendant any greater rights than the Supreme Court jurisprudence in this area. So what are the implications of Crawford and confrontation after Crawford? Well, we have the confrontation clause of the Sixth Amendment, hearsay rules, right, whether they're going to be admissible or inadmissible as a substitute for cross-examination. And of course, we have to always balance the admission of relevant evidence with the probative value versus the prejudicial effect. So again, Justice Scalia, Confrontation Clause excludes testimonial statements unless the declarant testifies or a witness is unavailable and there's a prior opportunity to cross-examine. You don't need actual cross-examination. You just have to have a prior opportunity. What does that mean? It could be waived. It could be forfeited. What was Justice Scalia so mad about? Well, I have my own theory. When the Constitution was adopted in 1791, we had an exception under the common law called spontaneous statements or spontaneous declarations. Our case law over the years, in more recent vintage, have expanded this to an excited utterance, which really is 5 minutes is okay, a half hour is okay, sometimes an hour is okay, sometimes 2 hours is okay, and depending on the circumstances, perhaps even more. So I think he was upset with that, the expansion of the spontaneous declaration, which was really immediately, on the immediate scene, you know, of the circumstances which stopped you from lying about an incident, and then was expanded by case law. But what did he say? He said the Sixth Amendment protection should not be subject to the vagaries of the rule of evidence, much less to the amorphous notions of reliability. What does that mean? Well, you go down to courtroom A with Judge Kamens, and you have a similar set of facts and circumstances, and there's a hearsay exception, a statement by a declarant, an out-of-court statement made by a declarant, sought to be admitted for the truth of the matter asserted, and Justice Kamens says, that's reliable. You go down to Leventhal's courtroom, down the other side of the hall with a similar set of facts and circumstances, same type of a statement, God bless you, same type of a statement, and I find it to be unreliable. And that's what he means by the amorphous notions of reliability. Each judge is going to decide what is and what is not reliable. He didn't like that. So how do we satisfy confrontation on the Crawford? Of course, if the declarant testifies, the declarant is subject to cross-examination. If the declarant is unavailable and there was a prior opportunity to cross-examine, if the statement is not testimonial, all right, and we have to get into what is and what is not testimonial, but if a statement is not testimonial, that satisfies Crawford. And another concept, which we'll go into a little bit, forfeiture by wrongdoing would satisfy Crawford. Now, a declarant testifies. That satisfies Crawford because the Confrontation Clause excludes testimonial statements unless the declarant testifies. What about poor memories at trial? Okay, you like that? I'll go back. All right. So let's take how some other courts have handled it. In this Wisconsin case, State versus Roquette, which is the Supreme Court of Wisconsin, at trial, the witness for the state claimed to remember nothing about a crime committed by the defendant after having such made statements to the investigators and at a preliminary hearing. The witness was treated as a hostile witness, but continued to reiterate that he remembered nothing. Roquette, the defendant, claimed that the admission of this testimony violated his Confrontation Clause rights. The court held that because the witness appeared for cross-examination, there was no Sixth Amendment violation. The defense was able to show that the witness's recollection was bad. It is therefore for the jury to determine the reliability, not the admissibility of the statements. Am I talking too fast? Oh, good. All right. In the Fowler versus State, actually came down the same day as the intermediate appellate court did in Hammond versus Indiana, which was subsumed into Davis versus Washington. And actually, I'll come back to that because the Florida case is more akin to the Wisconsin case. In State versus Miller, an intermediate Florida appellate court, the witness was available to testify at trial regarding his prior statement, but he had a faulty memory due to an injury unrelated to the criminal incident. The court held that a faulty memory does not result in a Confrontation Clause violation because the clause is satisfied if the defendant has the opportunity to bring out such matters as a witness's faulty memory. Now, Fowler versus Indiana, the reason why I'm citing to this is because the court did something very, very unusual, which I'm not sure I would agree with and too many courts would do. But the police officer responded to a 911 domestic disturbance call. The officer arrived 5 minutes after receiving the dispatch, observing blood on the wife's pants and shirt, and noticed she had a bloody nose. 10 minutes after arriving at the scene, the officer asked the wife what had happened. The wife, crying, told the officers that the defendant, her husband, had punched her in the face. At trial, the wife identified pictures of her taken on the date of the act of the incident, yet she refused to testify that the defendant had battered her. The officer was allowed, over objection, to recount the wife's statements that the defendant had battered her under the excited utterance exception. As for the Confrontation Clause issue, because there was also a hearsay objection made, as for the Confrontation Clause issue, the court held that a request for an order directing the witness to respond is necessary to preserve a Confrontation Clause objection to prior statements by the witness. Since the defendant did not do so, he forfeited his right of confrontation. I'm not sure I would agree with that, but it's an interesting way that this court has handled it. Now, this case in Minnesota Supreme Court is a very, very unusual case. The co-defendant had his own separate trial, and he's convicted of a crime that I really never heard of before, but in Minnesota, you could be convicted of unintentional felony murder in the second degree. And the people call him to the stand, and he's granted immunity. He takes the stand. He refused to answer all the questions except one. On cross-examination, he said he didn't intend to do it, it was an accident. The court basically held not only that he was unavailable to testify, the statement, his testimony at his first trial was not admissible. See, the people sought to introduce the statement at the first trial, which implicated the defendant who was on trial. And just because he answered one question did not make the witness available, and there was no guarantee of trustworthiness as the witness had a motive to lie at his own trial. So The getting back to reliability, even though reliability is not the touchstone of Crawford. So we have screening cases, and you may have some of those. Have anyone had a screening case here with, or in another room, virtual video, because the child or the woman is so traumatized that they don't want to testify in front of the defendant? All right, well, this is good then. Then you'll see this. The first case was Coy versus Iowa. It's a 1988 case. And later on, I'm going to give you the breakdown of the Supreme Court. Why? Because it's very unusual that Justice Scalia is always aligned in these types of confrontation cases. We're almost always aligned with the liberal arm, what is perceived to be the liberal arm of the Supreme Court. And don't forget, when he decided Crawford, he went into what is a witness, what is to bear testimony, and he relied on an 1828, I'm surprised he didn't find a 1791 dictionary, but he relied on an 1828 dictionary of what it means to bear witness to what it means to give testimony. So Justice Scalia basically held placing a screen between the defendant and the child victim. So what did this do? This struck down an Iowa statute that permitted that. Now, Justice O'Connor said, and this is precedent what is to come by her, if there is a particularized finding of necessity, in another instance, it may be okay. And what happens 2 years later? There's Maryland versus Craig. And this, in this case, and let me give you the breakdown. The opinion was written by Justice O'Connor with Rehnquist, White, Blackmun, and Kennedy. Scalia led the dissent with Brennan, Marshall, and Stevens. All right? So Scalia dissented in this case, and the Supreme Court ruled that the state's interest in protecting the child witness from trauma may be sufficiently important to justify the use of a special procedure that denies a defendant face-to-face confrontation. However, the state must first make an adequate showing of necessity, considering factors outlined by the court. I would note that Justice Scalia and Justice Thomas, as early as 1992 in a case called United States versus White, sought to overturn Ohio versus Roberts. So, confrontation is a specific means of testing reliability. We abandon the concept of reliability as to testimonial hearsay. What did he mean by that? He didn't say that confrontation is the only way to measure reliability. He didn't even say that confrontation is the best way to measure reliability. We can all conjure up examples, and we're not going to do it now, of how an exception to the hearsay rule may be more reliable than cross-examination in certain instances. But what he did say is that the only way that the Constitution allows us to test reliability and to measure reliability is the procedural rule that the Constitution mandates. That's through the crucible of cross-examination. So he says it's a procedural rule which we must follow when we deal with testimonial statements. So Judge Arnold in this case, which is a very interesting case, here we had virtual testimony via two-way video. So what did that mean? I mean, the child saw the defendant saw the child when the trial was going on. So the child actually testified. So they sought to introduce his pretrial, his out-of-court statement. Well, Judge Arnold for the Eighth Circuit held that this violated the Sixth Amendment because it may have diluted the truth-inducing effect. Thus, the admission of prior interview violated the Confrontation Clause. Because there was no confrontation at that trial, it was error to admit the prior out-of-court statement. Now, this is not a rotten case. Judge Siparik told me it's pronounced roten. This is a case that basically read breathe new light into a 1990 Court of Appeals case, People versus Cintron. And what happened here, defendant, a home health nurse, hit an elderly victim from behind with a hammer and demanded money. The Court of Appeals held that the Supreme Court did not exceed its authority when it made a finding of necessity to permit the 83-year-old witness to testify via two-way video. So that's the law in New York now. Article 65 of the CPL requires two-way video for child victim testimony upon a finding of vulnerability. But the Court of Appeals held this left open the pre-existing authority with regard to other types of witnesses. And basically, it upheld Cintron, a 1990 case which predated Crawford versus Washington. I wanted to tell you that the Supreme Court has not handled any cases with screening after Crawford. Despite this next case, which I'm going to give you the cite, because if you really have a screening case, you should really read this case. This is State versus Vogelsberg, and I'll give you the cite. It's 724 Northwest 2nd, 649. It's an intermediate Wisconsin court. I'm not giving it to you for the holding or anything, but he has a very good summary of all the screening cases up until 2006. And basically, what's interesting with this, that the state constitution in Minnesota actually says face-to-face in its confrontation clause. And face-to-face means face-to-face. And still, they did not give the defendant any more rights under the under the state constitution than under the Supreme Court jurisprudence. And basically, the holding here was Crawford does not overrule Craig. Here there is no Sixth Amendment violation when a trial court determines that a barrier between the witness and the accused is necessary. But again, I caution you that the Supreme Court of the United States has not ruled on this. Okay, remember what we were saying, what else satisfies Crawford? If the witness is unavailable, and I didn't have enough room here, there was prior testimony was subject, there was a prior opportunity to cross-examine by the defendant on the of the declarant who made the out-of-court statement. So let's deal with the diagonal from bottom left to upper right. Well, let me ask you, I know in New York City we hardly do preliminary hearings, and even in New York State, outside the city, I mean, they do some, but not too many. How many of you here have ever done a preliminary hearing? More than I thought. That's great. All right. But anyway, in California, the witness testifies at a preliminary hearing, not available at trial, and the California Supreme Court found that the preliminary hearing was a sufficient opportunity for cross-examination, so they admitted the testimony at the preliminary hearing. On the other hand, Colorado went the other way, and there may be different procedural rules. I didn't immerse myself in the procedural rules of these other states, but there may be different procedural rules dealing with preliminary hearings. And when we talk about procedural rules, I guess we should look at Blanton. Now, we don't have this in New York, but apparently in Florida with misdemeanor cases, you can do depositions. Who's admitted in Florida here? Did you know that? Okay. So in 2006, I was down in Jacksonville, and they asked me to do a Crawford lecture to their appellate conference. I was dying to ask them about the hanging chads, but I decided not to. In any event, all their intermediate appellate courts were there, and the Supreme Court was there, and they had two different intermediate appellate courts going the other way. One said that the deposition prior to trial was sufficient opportunity to cross-examine, and another appellate court said it was insufficient. Well, 2 years later, the Supreme Court of Florida came down saying that that was insufficient. It was used for impeachment, but was not sufficient opportunity to cross-examine on the issues relating to the trial. Now, Washington versus Sherman is a real wrinkle, and I don't know if we get a case like this, but you really have to think outside the box. In Washington versus Sherman, the defendant goes pro se, he gets convicted. He gets his conviction overturned because in Washington, if the judge doesn't tell a defendant in his allocution the maximum sentence that he is being facing, then it's an improper allocution, and therefore he didn't properly waive his right to have counsel. So what had happened, he gets a new trial, and now he's smart enough, he hires one of you guys, right? Ladies. And he has a lawyer at the trial, and the lawyer, and at the second trial, the main witness is not available. So the people try to introduce the testimony of the witness at the first trial, and the court, relying on a Supreme Court case called Mancusi versus Stubbs, which is a 1972 Supreme Court case, basically held that, look, you don't have to have the best cross-examination. The defense attorney didn't show any areas that the defendant didn't go into at the first trial or any purely ineffective cross-examination, so they allowed it. Just for your information, a Mancusi versus Stubbs, I don't know if any of you guys or ladies are like this, but the lawyer got the file, he said, I'm ready for trial. So the lawyer went for trial. The defendant was convicted, and Supreme Court of the United States said that's per se ineffective. You can't get a file and go to trial, you know, that day or the next day. So they said per se ineffective assistance of counsel. At the second trial, the witness was not available from the second trial, and they allowed the testimony from the first trial, even though they said it was ineffective assistance of counsel. They said that cross-examination was adequate, and it could be used at the testimony could be used at the second trial. So that's what Washington versus Sherman really was based on, the Supreme Court of Mancusi versus Stubbs. All right, so if the statement is not testimonial, that satisfies Crawford. And now the Supreme Court is forced to decide and further define what is and what is not testimonial. And there are two cases, Davis versus Washington and Hammond versus Indiana, one dealing with a 911 call, the other dealing with an on-scene incident. So what did they come up with? The primary purpose test, all right? So the Supreme Court said that an out-of-court statement sought to be admitted is not testimonial if the circumstances objectively indicate that the primary purpose was to obtain police assistance to meet an ongoing emergency. The Supreme Court also held that a statement is testimonial if the circumstances objectively indicate that the primary purpose is to establish past events relevant to a later criminal prosecution. So, in Davis, this was the 911 call. The court held that the primary purpose factors were met. Was the event or the incident actually happening, or did it occur in the past? Was it an ongoing emergency? Were the questions asked needed to resolve the ongoing emergency? And the level of formality? Now that's a little amorphous, but what I submit to you, consistent through all the Supreme Court jurisprudence in this area, is Justice Thomas. Justice Thomas says, and basically holds, that if it's not solemnized, if it's not formal, if it's not similar to in-court testimony or the ex parte examination that was done under the common law, then it's not testimonial. Even if it's sought to be admitted for the truth, it's not testimonial. And he is consistently, and formality is important when you remember we talk about affidavits. All right. The 911 call was deemed to be testimonial. Ms. McCrady called 911, described the events as they were actually happening. In fact, in the call, you heard the altercation going on with the defendant in the background, and asked for the police to help meet an ongoing emergency. The factors, the statements were made as the events were actually occurring. There was an ongoing emergency, and the questions asked were needed to resolve that emergency, and it was not formal. But not all of the 911 call was admissible. Once the operator gained the information, and also the woman said that he left. So once the operator gained the information necessary to resolve the emergency, the remainder was not testimonial. So once she said, oh, he left, and then they asked, well, what color is his car, where did he go, what does he look like, give me a description, that was deemed to be testimonial. However, we can all conjure up examples, again, where the emergency, just because he left, wasn't over. I'm going to come back and get you. I took the kids, or I'm going to come back and hurt the kids, something like that. So, but under these set of facts and circumstances, it stopped right there. All right, the on-scene statement was deemed to be testimonial. Amy, I'll let you look at this, and I'm going to give you really what happened. The police responded late on the night to a reported domestic disturbance. They found complainant alone on the front porch, appearing somewhat frightened, but she told the police nothing was the matter. The complainant gave the police permission to enter the house, where an officer saw a gas heating unit in the corner of the living room that had flames coming out of the partial glass front. There were pieces of glass, there were shards of glass on the ground in front, and there was flames emitting from the front of the heating unit. Now, what had happened here is that the police separated them and put the defendant in a room, and he kept on trying to get at the complainant, you know, wanted to see what she was going to say. And the key here, the wife signed an affidavit, what's called a battery affidavit. The complainant wrote, broke our furnace and shoved me down on the floor into the broken glass, hit me in the chest and threw me down, broke our lamps and phone, tore up my van where I couldn't leave the house, attacked my daughter. So we can all, any of you who have dealt with domestic violence knows that the emergency may not really be over just because the police come. And if the trial judge would have said that there was an ongoing emergency, the Supreme Court might have been stuck with that. But the Supreme Court basically said that the statements were about past events, the events that already happened. There was no ongoing emergency, they were separated, and again, I think they were stuck because the trial court didn't make a finding that there was an ongoing emergency. The questions were about facts relevant to future criminal prosecution. But really what brought this home for the defendant was the victim signed an affidavit, and that affidavit gave the level of formality that the Supreme Court said makes a statement testimonial. The next case is Michigan versus Bryant, a Supreme Court case. I'm going to give you the facts in one moment, but let me tell you how the judges voted. The opinion was written by Judge Sotomayor with Alito, Roberts, Kennedy, and Breyer. Thomas concurred. Dissent was Scalia and Ginsburg. Scalia and Ginsburg. And Kagan recused. So let me tell you what happens. The victim gets shot through a door. He doesn't see who shot him, but he recognizes the voice of the person who shot him. He gets in his car. He drives 6 blocks to a gas station. He gets out of the car, goes onto the premises of the gas station, and collapses. The police secure the gas station, and one of the police officers comes up to him and says, what happened? And he says, Bryant shot me. Now, what's interesting to note, which is not germane to this decision, but which is interesting to note, is that the prosecutors in Michigan abandoned the theory of dying declaration at the trial level, which might have been an interesting issue, but we don't have that here. So Justice Sotomayor says there was an ongoing emergency and applied the primary purpose test. And that was an important factor And what did she mean by that? There's someone out there with a gun. And it's broader than the initial threat. And we must consider the perspective of both the declarant, the victim, and the questioner, the police officer. And I think this leads to problems later on. Because what this means, and you'll see that later on in Illinois versus Williams, because what this means is that anytime there's a perp out there, a perpetrator, with a weapon, a gun or a knife, there's an ongoing emergency who's unapprehended. And, I mean, that's the jurisprudence right now, but that's what this real, that's the implications of this case. So then we go to Ohio versus Clark, which is the most recent case considered by the Supreme Court. And they pretty much all agree, but not on the theory of the case. But really what's interesting in this case, you have a defendant who's watching his girlfriend's two kids, and the 3.5-year-old goes to school, and he has marks on him, and the teacher examines him and sees there's more injuries on him, and she's a mandatory reporter of child abuse, and she reports it. At the trial, she is the one who testifies and not the child. Now, what was interesting to me, and apparently not to the Supreme Court, is that the Ohio statute has a dual purpose. I know if it's a primary purpose, has a dual purpose. One purpose is to aid the child from abuse, mandatory reporting, and the other one is to identify and prosecute the perpetrator. And that would be clearly testimonial, right? So that was the interesting aspect. In a 4-3 decision, the Ohio Supreme Court suppressed the, granted a new trial saying that there was a denial of the right to confrontation. The Supreme Court, in a decision by Judge Alito, said this is consistent with an ongoing emergency, didn't even discuss the dual purposes of the statute. Teachers should not return a child into an abusive environment. The primary purpose test is only a factor, not the factor, the linchpin, and there's no categorical rule regarding statements to individuals as possible confrontation problems. Well, Justice Scalia disagrees. He concurs with the result. He states that the primary purpose test is a categorical factor, not simply is a categorical rule, not a factor. And the burden is on the DA to prove that the statement is admissible, not on the defendant to prove that the statement is inadmissible. Now, Justice Thomas says, we should have decided whether a statement made to a private person is testimonial or not. And he believes that the same test should be as to a private person or law enforcement. And what he says is what he says throughout. There has to be an indicia of solemnity, almost like you're swearing. And he said this is not a statement when a teacher asks a kid what happened and it was Smith. He says that's not like giving testimony. This is not like the ex parte examination that confrontation was and Crawford was concerned with. So you make a statement to Oprah. It's not like making a statement to a policeman or to the DA. Right? And Judge Scalia says that an accuser who makes a formal statement to government officers bears testimony in a sense that a person who makes a casual remark to an acquaintance does not. Now, I have to caution you that after Clark, Ohio versus Clark, and there'll be another case, West Virginia versus Meckling, all the other cases that are cited here, if you look at this diagonal, Colorado and New York, you make a statement to your girlfriend, to your friend, it's not going to be scrutinized. I'm not going to say that it's never testimonial, but you're going to give it much more scrutiny if it's made to law enforcement than if it's made to a friend, a girlfriend, a cellmate. So now West Virginia versus Meckling was interesting because this is what Justice Thomas is basically saying. The Supreme Court of West Virginia remanded the case when the woman made a statement to her neighbor about her boyfriend assaulting her, to examine whether the statement to the neighbor was done for the purpose of meeting an ongoing emergency or to prosecute or to arrest the boyfriend. That's the most interesting case out there on this subject. But again, now, here's an unforeseen, and I really intended to put this, so I'm going to give you the site. It's an American Journal of Criminal Law published by the University of Texas School of Law. The site is 43 American Journal of Criminal Law, number one, page one. And it's an article that I'd written, and I apologize to you. This should have been in your materials. Is God bless you. Is Bruton on life support in the aftermath of Crawford v. Washington? And why do I say that? Because up until Crawford, if a defendant made a incriminating statement to his girlfriend, to his friend, to his neighbor, to his cellmate, incriminating not only himself but his co-defendant, you would either have a severance at trial or you would have a completely redacted statement under the trilogy of Bruton, Richardson versus Marsh, and Gray versus Maryland, right? So you would have, that would happen. But in the aftermath of Crawford, and I ask you to read this, I would ask you to read this article. In the aftermath of Crawford, if a defendant makes a statement implicating himself and his co-defendant to his cellmate, to his girlfriend, I'm not talking about to authorities, because Bruton's still good law when it is to authorities, but when he makes a statement to a civilian, the courts have pretty much consistently held that that statement is non-testimonial, and therefore, on the confrontation jurisprudence, I'm not talking about evidentiary rules, state evidentiary rules. On the confrontation jurisprudence, there's no violation of Bruton. There's no violation of confrontation. And what does this mean? If someone fails to object, it's not of constitutional dimension. Or if there is an error on the crimens, it's subject to less of a standard when the reviewing appellate court is going to decide whether to reverse or not, and has further implications, because if there is a hearsay exception, even if an objection is made, if there is a hearsay objection, there might be an excited utterance or a present sense impression or whatever one can come up with, then it's admissible. So when it comes to civilians, an implicating statement that implicates a co-defendant as well as the declarant, the out-of-court statement, there's no violation of Bruton and Cruz. This has not gone up to the Supreme Court of the United States, but the circuit courts that have held this and the state courts that have considered this have found that there's no confrontation clause violation. Now, I just want to, a new case that came out is People, which is not in your outline, is People versus Johnson at 27 New York 3rd, 60, which really doesn't add anything to the dialogue, but I want to bring it to your attention because we really have all the Court of Appeals cases in here except for that one. And that case basically said that the admission of the co-defendant's grand jury testimony at the defendant's trial was a violation of confrontation when the co-defendant did not testify. They were jointly tried together. But I'll let you read that yourself. That's 27 New York 3rd, 60. And I think the pertinent pages are 67 and 68. Right, Barry? All right. 65. The next very important case is Melendez-Diaz versus Massachusetts. Did we get that? Yeah. The drug lab report was deemed testimonial. The analysts certified lab reports, and they were the equivalent. They were done for the purpose of prosecution, and they were the equivalent of affidavits. So what did the lab report show? It showed what the contents consisted of was a contraband, right, which is a crime, and the weight is the degree of the crime. So Justice Scalia said the certified lab report was equal to an affidavit or testimonial statements. There are no neutral witnesses against an accused. Kennedy said, oh, these are neutral witnesses. Am I the only one warm in here? Is it hot in here?
Yeah.
Could we cool it off a little bit? If we could? There are no neutral witnesses against an accused. And he said the compulsory process clause of the Sixth Amendment is no substitute for the confrontation clause. In other words, just because the defendant can call witnesses on his case doesn't mean that the people do not have the burden of producing evidence against the defendant and witnesses against the defendant. What he did say, which is quite interesting, I'll say it again because you might not have heard. What he did say, which is quite interesting, is that notice and demand statutes may withstand constitutional muster. What did he mean by that? He meant that if the prosecution filed a paper with the defense or the defendant's attorney, saying, we intend to introduce the lab report, you have 10 days or 15 days to tell us whether you are going to demand the witness to be produced. And if you don't, then you've given up that right. And Justice Scalia says, a defendant always has to assert his rights, that if he doesn't, he could waive the right to cross-examine. And this may pass constitutional muster. So Kennedy was concerned about autopsies, the statute of limitation of autopsies. You know, we have a medical examiner who either dies or moves out of state or out of country or becomes incompetent. We can't do a second autopsy. However, I want to let you know that every state that has considered this, including our state and Fresenet, we have noted that the autopsy report is non-testimonial. And what can happen is they can go through the findings as long as the expert who didn't conduct the testing forms its own conclusion and just doesn't parrot the conclusions of the expert in the report, then that would be okay. So he was also concerned about the availability of witnesses, especially FBI witnesses, that they'll be testifying all around the country, and also we have to pull these scientists out of labs, and what are we going to do? They won't be able to do what they're supposed to do, and they're neutral, and they're not at the scene. So, just give me one second. I just want to let you know, and I'm not going to go into this now, I have a bunch of articles here, just in New York. There were problems with the Office of Chief Medical Examiner's lab, there was problems with the state lab, there was problems with the Nassau County lab. So I really think this is a really good thing. And what Justice Kennedy was also concerned about, that this was a windfall for the defendants because they will always demand now, they will never stipulate to the weight and the content of the drugs because they're hoping that the analyst won't be produced. All right, that was his concern. All right. So now, next one we have Bull Cumming versus New Mexico. And I'll answer questions at the end, if there's time. Bull Cumming versus New Mexico. The majority, Ginsburg, Scalia, Thomas, Kagan, Sotomayor. The dissent, Kennedy, Roberts, Breyer, and Alito. This was a lab test on a driving under the influence. And the analyst who certified the report was put on unpaid leave for undisclosed reasons. The supervisor, her supervisor, she didn't supervise the test, her supervisor testified about the general practices of the lab and the testing facility. And the court basically held that the Sixth Amendment does not permit the introduction of the lab report containing testimonial certification through in-court testimony of a scientist who had not signed the certification nor performed or observe the test. And Justice Ginsburg said, a document created solely for an evidentiary purpose made in aid of a police investigation ranks as testimonial. Now, this is what Justice Scalia was concerned about. Defendant had a Sixth Amendment right to cross-examine the analyst. It's not simple. It's subject to human error at each test. And there are three types of error that really could be discerned. And you'll see that later on when we get to Illinois v. Williams, because I'm going to read you the first page of Kagan's, well, they call it a dissent, but it's 4-4, so I don't know why they're calling it a dissent or a plurality, except that it's precedent as to Mr. Williams, who remains convicted. But in any event, it's subject to human error at each step. What are some of the errors? Dry labbing. That means the test is not even performed at all. It could be fraud. There have been circumstances, even in New York, where the expert has made up the results. And there's also human error. And how do you discover that? Through the crucible of cross-examination. All right, and a witness did not observe, conduct, or supervise the test, and that's similar to People versus Johns, the New York case, which is in your outline, which basically says that if the witness who testifies did not supervise, observe, or conduct the test, that it should not be admissible. One thing you should know is that Judge Scalia in Melendez-Diaz said you don't have to call every analyst in the chain of custody, all right? But you do have to call one who knows what's going on. All right. This is a most peculiar case. I don't know what you can make out of it, but we'll discuss it anyway. This is a 2012 Supreme Court case. The problem that I have with this case, with the Alito group, the four, and I guess I should give you the breakdown. Alito, Roberts, Kennedy, and Breyer, and they call that the majority because defendant was convicted below. So because it's a tie, he remains convicted. And because, and I'll go into this in a minute, because of what Justice Thomas said, he remains convicted. Because he said it was all right to admit this, but not for the same rationale. So this has no precedential purpose for very little, except that the statement was admitted for its truth, but Justice Thomas doesn't think that it was testimonial. The other four say that it was non-testimonial, and also for the fact that Justice Thomas agrees with Kagan that the primary purpose test should not apply, and that it's just okay because it wasn't solemn enough. So Judge Thomas has his foot in both camps, but there's really no majority opinion here. So what happened here? The woman is raped, and the semen is collected at the scene, and it went to Selmark Laboratory, an outside lab. 1 year later, the victim identified the defendant. The prosecutor calls an expert who identified the DNA profile by the outside independent laboratory, matched a profile produced by the state police lab using a sample of petitioner's blood. Under the Illinois rules of evidence, this was an Illinois case, obviously, the report cannot be considered to prove the truth of the matter asserted, but was allowed to show how the expert's conclusion was reached. And generally, that's the rule. An expert can use even hearsay to form its opinion. It can use a lot of things to form his opinion. But he can't be a conduit for inadmissible hearsay. If he can't regurgitate that hearsay of what the person told him, and that's Goldstein, which you'll hear in a minute, because there's no opportunity to cross-examine those witnesses that he's regurgitating what they told him. So here is the pitfall. We have Justice Alito, who employed the primary purpose test. And this is what I said, the danger, what Bull Cumming created with Judge Sotomayor. She said that there's someone out there, a perpetrator, who's unapprehended, and this rapist who committed this rape a year ago, he's out there. So we have to catch him. So this is the primary purpose test has to be applied. And the profile of the outside lab, Selmark, was not inherently inculpatory. Why? Because DNA exculpates everyone except for one person. So that's his rationale. And an expert may base an opinion on facts that are made known to the expert, and it doesn't constitute admissible evidence of the underlying information. Right. And this was a bench trial, which is important, because the actual Cellmark report wasn't admitted at the trial. It wasn't admitted. And they and everyone thinks we judges are so brilliant that we could discern what the jury couldn't. So it may not be okay in a jury trial, but the judge can understand the significance of what evidence is in and what evidence is not in. And now, what about stare decisis? Remember, Melendez-Diaz came out in 2009, and Bull Cumming came out in 2011. So this case is 2012. And now, Justice Alito says, oh, the compulsory process serve and evidentiary safeguards are enough, when Scalia said, the compulsory process clause is not a substitute for the confrontation clause. What happened to stare decisis, recent precedent? Is Professor Farrell here? No. Well, Professor Farrell went before the Supreme Court in Blockberger. And he convinced the Supreme Court to overturn a two-year precedent. But I never saw this before. Professor Farrell did this in Grady versus Corbin, same elements versus same conduct test versus same elements test in Double Jeopardy, United States versus Dixon. But in any event, here they're basing the majority, which is not really a majority, but the opinion on what was rejected in Bull Cumming and in Melendez-Diaz. And then even if it was admitted for its truth, it's not a confrontation clause violation. And Thomas agrees with that. It's admitted for the truth, but it's not a confrontation clause violation because it's not solemn enough. So what would Breyer like to do? He'd like to re-argument, to go over Melendez-Diaz and Bull Cumming regarding compulsory process clause and hardship in calling analysts to testify. That was rejected less than 2 or 3 years ago. And Thomas agrees with the Kagan plurality that the facts in the outside lab report is admitted for its truth, but is admissible as it is not testimonial, and he rejects the primary purpose test. Now, Melendez-Diaz and Bull Cumming are good recent precedent are applicable here. This is Judge Kagan, I agree. There's no distinction between those cases and this one. There is no ongoing emergency, so the primary purpose test does not apply, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You could read this, all right? And she also agrees that it might only apply to a bench trial if it applies at all. But let me just read to you the first page of her opinion. Some years ago, the state of California prosecuted a man named John Kosak for rape. At a preliminary hearing, the state presented testimony from an analyst at the Cellmark Diagnostics Laboratory, the same facility used to generate DNA evidence in this case. The analyst had extracted DNA from a bloody sweatshirt found at the crime scene and then compared it to two control samples, one from Kosak and one from the victim. The analyst's report identified a single match. As she explained on direct examination, the DNA found on the sweatshirt belonged to Kosak. But after undergoing cross-examination, the analyst realized she had made a mortifying error. She took the stand again, but this time to admit that the report listed the victim's control sample as coming from Kosak and Kosak's as coming from the victim. And how did this come out? Through cross-examination. So, I just think, and this is not just my opinion, there's all kinds of articles which criticize the Supreme Court's decision in that, but I'm just going to give you a brief quote from a Second Circuit case, People versus Jamaica and Malloy. In part, Williams does not, as far as we can determine, yield us a single useful holding relevant to the case before us. We think it's sufficient to conclude that we must rely on Supreme Court precedent before Williams to the effect that a statement triggers the protections of the Confrontation Clause when it is made with the primary purpose of creating a record for use at a later criminal trial. And this cites all the prior Supreme Court precedent before Williams. All right, forfeiture by wrongdoing. Well, look at this party animal. Chief Justice, wait, all right? Now, in this case, the witness's testimony from a prior trial charging defendant with polygamy, this was a Utah case, was sought to be used against the defendant at a second trial. The absent witness was the alleged second wife of the accused. Defendant kept his wife away from home so that she could not be subpoenaed to testify. So, the rule of forfeiture by wrongdoing extinguishes confrontation claims on essentially equitable grounds. This is not reliability, this is not hearsay, it's not on any of these grounds, on reliability, confrontation, it's on equitable grounds. And the court held that where the defendant voluntarily keeps a witness away, he cannot insist on the privilege, and if, when absent by the procurement, their evidence is supplied in some lawful way, he is in no condition to assert that his constitutional rights have been violated. The court grounded its decision that no one should be permitted to take advantage of its own wrongdoing. And we all know, I'm going to go through this quickly because I only have 15 minutes, right? Okay, a witness is unavailable through acts by the defendant intended, this third one is very important, to make the witness unavailable, and the acts actually made the witness unavailable. All right. You all know that in New York, the burden is by clear and convincing evidence. In most states, that's under Cotto, Geraci, Hildebrand versus Holtzman, et cetera, and Mastrangelo in the federal, and in most states, it's by preponderance of the credible evidence. Hearsay can be used to prove forfeiture. Okay, so then the Supreme Court was faced with this issue, because up until then, there was divergence in the state and federal courts whether you actually had to intend to keep the witness away from testifying, or actually you just had to cause the witness. You kill someone. How do you know if you intended to keep them from testifying at the trial of a prior domestic violence or criminal incident, or it could even be an organized crime case, right? Or did you just cause them to be? And this is very hard to discern. And I'll tell you, at the beginning, when I read cases before this came out, including one called Kansas versus Meeks, where it was held by the trial, by the Supreme Court of Kansas, that the trial judge can determine by a preponderance of the evidence that the defendant probably killed the woman, therefore we're going to let the prior statements in. How does a judge decide the guy's probably guilty and we're going to let him in, you know? But when I read the dissent in this, they have some very compelling arguments. So in this case, Giles kills his former girlfriend to keep him from cheating on him. Very unusual way to do that. And the state sought to introduce her prior statements to the police. Scalia and the court, and I'll give you the breakdown. It's Scalia, Roberts, Alito, Thomas, Ginsburg, and Souter. The dissent was Breyer, Stevens, and Kennedy. Murder alone was not enough. The proponent must show an intent to procure the unavailability of the witness. Okay, so I'm not going to go through these because I don't want to run out of time. The dissent, the concerns of the dissent, Lord Morley's case was broad enough. Lord Morley's case was a 1666 case under the, talking too fast? No. Under the common law, where they were having a coroner's inquest and the prisoner kept the witness away and therefore they allowed the witnesses prior statement. So they go back to Lord Morley's case. Also, the concept, there's no benefit from wrongdoing, right? That's Reynolds, the first case in 1879 the Supreme Court considered. The life insurance analogy, that you cannot, and other analogies in the civil law, that you, if you're the beneficiary of an insurance policy and you kill the insured, you're not going to be able to collect. And knowing intent, knowing murder, equals intent because it could be inferred that you intended to keep the person away from the witness from testifying. And here's the dichotomy. If you have an assault and a threat, there might be forfeiture because the witness will come in and testify that she's been threatened. But you have an assault and a murder and the witness might not be able to come in to testify, there is no forfeiture. And evidentiary safeguards are enough. So even though I had a problem with Kansas versus Meeks, I really think the concerns of the minority are really legitimate. All right, so by the way, postscript. Case goes back to remanded, and the California court found that the people were unable to prove that Giles intended by killing the decedent to keep her away from testifying, and therefore the prior statements were not admissible at his subsequent trial. All right, things to consider: is the witness unavailable? I'm going to go through this quickly. Is there a prior history of abuse? Are there prior current attempts to dissuade cooperation? And there were ongoing criminal proceedings when the victim was going to testify at time of threats. One thing which was very interesting in Giles, which I didn't know, and I wonder how many of you knew, that until 1985, forfeiture by wrongdoing was not used in any other context other than tampering with a witness. So I didn't know that. In any event, context, totality of the circumstances, pre-incident, incident, post-incident. All right, you could also open the door. This is a case which is in your outline, People versus Reed, authored by Judge Piggott. Here the defendant and witness intimated that the police received information that another was involved in a shooting. The prosecutor was then allowed to ask the agent whether he received an eyewitness testimony about who was at the murder. The agent answered that he was told that the third party was not at the scene. Now, the Court of Appeals held the defendant should not be allowed to mislead the jury. Therefore, the hearsay is admissible without the defendant being afforded an opportunity to cross-examine. So we can't let a fraud be perpetrated against the jury. We have to correct it. So the hearsay was admissible. All right, other issues that might come up. Multidisciplinary teams, admissions, retroactivity, dying declarations, and medical diagnosis and treatment. So Crawford is not retroactive on collateral review. And this case is Wharton v. Bochting. It does not apply to convictions that were already final as of March 8, 2004. Now, one thing hidden in Wharton v. Bochting, and people didn't realize that at the time, until Wharton v. Bochting came down, a lot of states and federal courts were applying Ohio versus Roberts for non-testimonial statements, which is kind of interesting, because actually Ohio versus Roberts had more protection for non-testimonial statements than Crawford. What do I mean by that? I'm only talking about confrontation now. I'm not talking about rules against hearsay. Because under Ohio versus Roberts, a statement would be admissible if it was either reliable under the hearsay rules, exception to the hearsay rules, or it was subject to cross-examination. Once Crawford came down, Wharton v. Bochting said, we don't care about reliability in testimonial statements. So therefore, non-testimonial statements are no longer subject to confrontation, right? And we don't care anything about the Sixth Amendment reliability. It might be subject to state evidentiary rules, non-testimonial statements, but has no implication to the Confrontation Clause. So everyone cites Wharton v. Bochting for the proposition that it's not retroactive, but in Wharton v. Bochting, it also says Ohio versus Roberts has no vitality for non-testimonial statements. There's no confrontation analysis necessary. There may be state evidentiary hearsay rules, but not confrontation rules. All right. Danforth versus Minnesota. The states may give broader retroactivity to new rules of criminal procedure than that given by the federal courts. So Wharton v. Bochting said on the habeas, no retroactivity. But under a 440 in New York, although we know Pique, right, I don't know how you pronounce it, Pique regarding Padilla is not retroactive. But no, the Court of Appeals has not decided whether if someone brought a 440 in the retroactivity under Crawford, whether that would be retroactive. I would say it probably is going to find that it's not retroactive because it would open up too many floodgates on prior, you know, because prior conviction. And Lateague versus Lane analysis, I don't think it'll pass mustard. All right. Expert opinions. An expert may rely on hearsay to form their opinion. There's no problem for a pathologist relying, I talked about this, on an autopsy report of another on the facts, but he must form his own conclusions. He can't parrot the conclusions. He must form his own independent conclusion. You're kidding. All right. And in People v. Goldstein, which was cited by Judge Thomas and by Judge Kagan in Illinois versus Williams, you can't have a conduit of inadmissible hearsay because the expert testified to what people told them without the defendant being able to cross-examine. So I have to go quickly. Dying declarations. All right. Although many dying declarations may not be testimonial, there is authority for admitting even those that clearly are. We need not decide in this case whether the Sixth Amendment incorporates an exception for testimonial dying declarations. If this exception must be accepted on historical grounds, it is sui generis. That's footnote 6 in Crawford. And People versus Clay, an intermediate appellate court here in New York, the Second Department, the dying declaration was testimonial, but it's okay under the firmly rooted hearsay exception. Admissions, I'm not going to even go into that. Admissions don't come under the Confrontation Clause. If it's not offered to the truth of the matter asserted, it's not testimonial. Medical diagnosis of treatment. The identity of the perpetrator is not ordinarily admissible, but it can be admissible if there is a medical reason. For example, domestic violence, child abuse, or sexual abuse of a child. You don't want to return the patient to the perpetrator, right? So who the identity of the perpetrator may be important for diagnosis and treatment. And I'm just going to show you down to the right. I'm running out of time. The New York case, Ortega and Benston, the Court of Appeals basically said that the statements made to the, and I'll let you read them, and they're in your materials, basically said that certain of the statements made to the doctor and nurse at the emergency room were admittable for diagnosis and treatment. Multidisciplinary team, you don't want to re-victimize a child or a rape victim by telling it over and over to the psychologist, to the psychiatrist, to the police officer, to the prosecutor. So they have multidisciplinary teams, all right? So they're split now nationally. In Minnesota, the interview's primary purpose was to prosecute child, I'm sorry, was to protect the child, not to prosecute in the federal habeas corpus. So that was okay. Yet in Florida and Hernandez, the child statement to the nurse at a child protection team, which included the police, was equivalent to police interrogation. Oh, I'm almost finished. Okay. Confrontation does not apply, right? The Confrontation Clause does not apply to civil proceedings, to probation revocation proceedings, to sentencing hearings. Why do I have a question mark? Because when you have a capital case where you may have a death penalty, I'm not sure what the Supreme Court will do regarding confrontation on that. Restitution hearings, suppression hearings, SORA or SAMTA hearings, probable cause hearings, and hearsay offered by a defendant does not apply. What does it apply to? Only criminal trials. Only criminal trials. I have 3 minutes for questions.
Question.
1 minute.
With regard to Ohio versus Robert,
yes.
Okay, open it up.
Okay.
With regard to Ohio versus Robert, is Ohio versus Robert dead when it comes to non-testimonial hearsay statements in state court?
Okay. It may be subject to state evidentiary rules. Oh, the question was, is Ohio versus Roberts dead in state court?
With regard to non-testimonial
statements. It's dead in the confrontation Sixth Amendment context. There's no prohibition admitting non-testimonial statements under the Sixth Amendment. There may be state evidentiary rules which will prevent those type of statements coming in. But if someone doesn't object, and or if they do object and the judge makes a mistake, it's not subject to the same Crimmins analogy as a constitutional violation. It would be a hearsay violation. And there might be an exception to the hearsay rule where it can come in. That's it.